Good day and welcome to the Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited 4Q FY20 earnings conference call hosted by Antique Stock Broking. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in listen-only mode and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star and zero on your touchtone phone. Please note this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Nitin Tiwari of Antique Stock Broking. Thank you and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Vikram. Good day. On behalf of Antique Stock Broking, I welcome everyone to HPCL's fourth quarter earnings call. I hope that everyone is keeping healthy and safe. Today, we have the pleasure of having with us the senior management team from HPCL, represented by CMD, Mr. Sarana, Director of Finance, Mr. Kesavan, and ED Corporate Finance, Mr. Naran. Without much ado, I now hand over the floor to management for opening comments, which shall be followed by Q&A session. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon to everybody. My name is Sarana. I'm a CNMD of HPCL. With me, Director of Finance, HPCL, Mr. Keshwan, and ED Corporate Finance, Mr. Rajnish Narang is with me.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone.
So, thank you very much for joining in all the guests to this conference call. Yesterday, HPCL has announced its results for Q4 as well as the financial year ended 31st March 2020. Which most of the detail you may already have got, and but just to have a recapitulation of this, in my opening remarks, and you are aware that HPCL did the highest ever sales of 39.6 million metric ton compared to 38.7 million metric ton last year, and this is in spite of the last 10 days of lockdown situation because of COVID pandemic. Our motor spirit growth was 4.7%. LPG sales grew by 7.3%. Industrial and consumer segment, which is B2B segment, we did a business of around 5 million metric tons. Lubes, which has been a strong point of HPCL, we continued to be the number one lube marketeer in the company, as the country, which includes the private sector as well as the public sector. Not only in the total lube sales, but also value-added sales, and we also made the highest exports of lube in the year. HPCL also put its foot on the overseas in terms of retail business, and we started our first retail outlet in Bhutan. We had gone into a MOU with the State Trading Corporation of Bhutan, and we will be setting up another 20 retail outlets there under co-branding of HPCL and State Trading Corporation of Bhutan. LPG, we continued to be the second largest player in the country. The LPG demand was reasonably good, higher than the last year, backed by PMEY pushed by the government. And also in this year, because of the additional three cylinders which has been provided to PMEY beneficiaries. HPCL total customer base on LPG has gone to around 8 crores now. As far as refineries are concerned, we had a capacity utilization of 109%. As you are aware, HPCL always have been operating its refinery above 100% capacity. We had the highest ever lube base oil production of 478 CNT. HPCL has got the largest lube refinery in the country. We also launched certain new products which include very low sulfur fuel oil, less than 0.5% to meet the MARPOL requirement. The complete range of lubricants for BS6 compliance fuels and also for electric vehicles. In the Q4, the total, in the year, our total gross revenue was 2,86,250 crores versus 2,95,730 crores last year. We also, during the period, upgraded our refineries for BS6 production, both the refineries. In Vizag refinery, we also completed, along with this upgrade, the revamp of the secondary unit to cater to the increased throughput, which will be coming up as a part of the Vizag refinery expansion project, which is in the advanced stage. We commissioned number of projects, which include Uranchak and Shikrapur pipeline, which is an LPG pipeline, and it will reduce the ply of trucks, tankers on Mumbai-Pune highway. We completed Palanpur-Vadodara pipeline and MDPL capacity expansion along with the new Baroda terminal ahead of time, which was 6 months ahead of time in 90% of the cost, saving almost 190 crores. Apart from other various projects to increase our capacity and augmenting our marketing infrastructure. We also added 1,194 new retail outlets during the year, which is the highest number of retail outlets commissioned in a year, and 245 new LPG distributorships. So as of today, we have got 16,476 retail outlets and 6,110 LPG distributors. This is the figure as of 31st March 2020, after which there will be certain further addition. In gas business, HPCL has commenced CNG sales at 476 outlets. Our construction activities at Chara terminal, which is the LNG gasification terminal, is in progress. HPCL is also participating in two cross-country natural gas pipelines. We have got authorization for 20 geographical areas in the country. In the 10th round, bidding round for gas, we were the most successful bidder, winning as many as 9 GAs out of it. As apart from the physical parts, which I thought that would be good to recapitulate, as you are already aware that this year was a bit of an unprecedented year, and especially the last quarter, we have seen some of the events which I don't think any of us in this generation has seen it. The issues were both on the demand side as well as supply side. The demand side was facing the issues because of general global economic slowness, and it followed the COVID-19 pandemic outbreak in most of the countries in the world, leading to nationwide lockdowns, complete destruction of the demand. On the supply side, OPEC plus countries in their efforts to stabilize the supply demand situation, to stabilize the prices, had initially a disagreement which led to a price war, which led to surplus productions, additional inventories in the market. Subsequently, some amount of agreement was reached, followed by substantial production cuts. But during this period, the crude prices and the product prices saw a high amount of volatility. The crude prices went as low as $13 a barrel at some point of time. It again picked up to around $35-$40. But in this run, it saw number of ups and downs. As you are aware that the volatility in the prices results into inventory gains and loss as far as oil companies are concerned. The surplus inventories, lower demand, the twin effect of those, has, and of course the geopolitical conditions, had led to various variations in the crude oil prices. During this period, in spite of a nationwide lockdown in the country, effective 24th of March, which initially was 3 weeks and then it was extended subsequently a couple of times, HPCL, being in the business of essential commodities, continued its operations without any disruption to ensure that LPG, petrol and diesel are available for essential services and general public. And at the same time, we also had to ensure that safety and well-being of all our stakeholders, our employees and our workforce. And I'm happy to share that HPCL had been able to manage that, where in spite of the higher demand of LPG and the lower demand of MS and HSD, in a refinery setup, that becomes a bit quite challenging task, but that same could be managed. Unlike our competitors or the colleague industries where the refinery run rates were required to be regulated substantially, most of the refineries operated at 50 to 60% of the capacity. HPCL was able to run its refineries to a substantially higher capacity utilization. Vizag refinery we could run at around 100%. Mumbai refinery also at around 85%. As far as the situation today, the demand, as I mentioned to you, there was substantial contraction of demand after the lockdown during the month of end March, April. The total demand of transportation fuels came as low as 30 to 40% in the month of April, which picked up subsequently. It became around 60% in May. And with the gradual relaxation in the lockout conditions, it picked up further in the month of June. And as of now, the demand for MS and HSD has already reached 82 to 88% of normal requirement, which was seen in the last year, the same month. We are hopeful that by end of June, it should be touching 90%. And further to that, in my opinion, it will depend on how the industries and the construction activities and the further part of the relaxation takes place to make it reach further to 100%. But the recovery in the demand was quite V-shaped, rapid, better than expected, and that's a good sign for industries also. In our sector, ATF demand is yet to pick up. It is reached around 30% or so with the domestic flights having started. But with more and more domestic travels and international flights opening, then the ATF demand will take up further. On the other products like bitumen, lubricants, etc., also the demand has picked up and we are seeing the almost 80% of demand returning back on these products also, on the back of some of the construction activities, road repairs, road work is starting, and the associated lubricant business requirement for transportation, etc. As far as the financial part is concerned, in the last year, the profit after tax was 2,637 crore. Versus 6,029 crore the previous year. Similarly, in the Q4, the profit was 27 crore versus 2,970 crore. The reduction in profit was mainly both in Q4 as well as the whole year, because the maximum impact of that is in Q4 itself, is because of two main factors. One thing is the inventory losses because of steep fall in the crude oil prices. The inventory loss for Q4 was 4,113 crore versus a gain of 1,224 crore the previous year same quarter. That itself amounts to 5,300 crore difference. The second thing was exchange rate fluctuation, which was 975 crore loss versus 256 crore gain. That is another around 700 crore. So these two factors put together amounts to around 6,500 crore of difference in the quarter. The similar figure for the year was 4,253 crore for inventory loss in the year compared to 1,366 crore gain the previous year. So that is again around 5,500 crore. And there is 200 crore additional inventory exchange rate fluctuation loss. So 250 crore plus 5,500 crore is 5,700 crore is the, on the yearly basis, these two factors. As far as GRMs are concerned, the GRM, reported GRM for the quarter was negative, mainly because of the lower cracks and inventory loss. The inventory loss was to the extent of $10.6. So the core GRM was 9.37. For the year, the reported GRM was 1.02, but after accounting for inventory loss, the core GRM was $4.30 per barrel compared to $4.23 last year. One of the items which some of you would have seen that HPCL has shifted to the newer taxation regime. We have adopted the 25% tax regime compared to 35% earlier. Because HPCL did not have an accumulated MAT, and so it was advantageous for us to shift to this regime. Also, we did a long-term analysis of this, and we found it is beneficial for the corporation to shift to a newer regime in this year. As a consequence of that, we had a deferred tax liabilities which were stated in the books of accounts at 35% of the taxation, which were reinstated the revised taxation. It led to write-on of certain taxation liabilities, which is reflecting in PAT. We also made certain provisions related to the conservative principle, and those impacts has also been taken in the results. There is one item of exceptional item 1,004 crore of 1,003 crore because of the inventory loss, which has been mentioned separately. But I just wish to clarify that this is a part of the total inventory gain losses. It is also a part of PAT. It is only a way of depicting because this was an unprecedented time where the lockdown happened. The 31st March fell in between the cutoff date, and the subsequent price was lower than the what is the cost. And as per the accounting principle, we are supposed to value the inventory at lower of the cost or the realizable value. But we are also aware that subsequently again it picked it up, and that is why it has been shown separately, while the normal inventory gain or loss are a part of the separate line item to give a better view to investors and the people who are reading the balance sheet and the profit and loss account that this is an item which is specific to this year. Impact of COVID because of the lockdown conditions and 50 drop in the prices. So with this, I also can share that we have declared a dividend of 9.75 rupees per share. Some people would have been surprised by that because it is almost more than 50%, 57% or so. But management believes that the investors had stood by HPCL in all thick and thin, and there may be an exceptional quarter, but the inherent strength of the company, there are no changes, even though because of the inventory losses or the foreign exchange variation, the PAT figure may look lower than what normally is, but the physical performance of the company had been in line with the previous year and the expectations. And we are quite hopeful of reclaiming that ground again. And therefore, we thought to ensure that the investors are rewarded for their remaining with HPCL. And that's why a dividend of 9.75 rupees has been declared. And the cash flow position for the company, we are quite sure about it. And that is why we thought of being here. One question which many people would have had, and I would like to reply it upfront so that it may solve some of the questions, that is regarding the debt. So the balance sheet must be saying 43,000 crore as the debt. It consists of long-term and short-term both. The short-term debt was required in this case, especially because as of 31st March, from 21st March onwards, there was a lockdown condition started. So the sale has come down to almost 25-30%. So the receipts has reduced. But when we buy the crude, we normally have the payment terms because we are able to command that 30 to 60 days payment terms which we have. So we are required to make the payments for the crude which is procured in the earlier months. Added to that, there are certain taxation payments which we are required to do at the end of the month or at the end of the year. So that needs the funds, and that's why the short-term borrowing was there, which was a part of this 43,000 crore total debt. but I'm happy to share that has already come down. And as of today, we have got a borrowing of only 36,000 crore. And by the end of the month, that is in another 10 days or so, it will come down to 32,000 and or even maybe lesser than that. So with this out of the total debt, our debt equity ratio on long-term debt is less than one, even with this amount. I think this covers, and one more question on the capex part of it. So we have got a capex of around 12,000 crore for this current year. Our some of the projects got completed in the last year, which include MDPL pipeline capacity expansion, Palanpur Vadodara pipeline, Uran Chakan Shikrapur pipeline, our VVSPL pipeline capacity expansion, our Hisar depot, Sugoli LPG plant, revamp of some five or six LPG plants, Kanpur terminal, wagon loading facility, new Vadodara terminal. Those projects have got completed. The main projects, which are Mumbai refinery expansion and Vizag refinery expansion, they are in advanced stage, and we are continuing with that, and we wish to complete it as early as possible. As I mentioned to you, that the revamp part of the project in Vizag refinery and BS6 part of the project has already been completed and commissioned, and the balance new units are in advanced stages. Similarly, Mumbai refinery also BS6 rollout has happened as per schedule, and the revamp part will be the capacity expansion plan is in progress. Barmer refinery, the activities are on, but the actual capex cycle for the expenditure is slightly later on that, because initial stages of the thing, engineering, procurement, etc., are in progress, and therefore we don't see any issue in completing all our projects which we have on our hand. Some of the projects are in very very advanced stage, and we should be seeing progressive completion of those projects in this year or early next year. And of course, on the newer projects, we are following a bit of a cautious approach, and to ensure that we are conscious of the situations as it develops, and the prioritizing of that. As far as the project sites are concerned, initially when the lockdowns were declared, we had closed all our project sites for the welfare and safety of our workers. But effective 20th of April 2020, when the relaxation came and the concerned local authorities started allowing it, I'm happy to share that all the project sites have been restarted and the projects have started. Of course, the full workforce is yet to return. But even as of today, in Vizag refinery expansion project, we have got around 7,000 people coming in. We want to escalate further to pre-lockdown period. In Barmer project, around 2,000 people are coming. Even HMEL, our joint venture petrochemical project, also around 14,000 people were coming. All other projects are also, the people have started returning back. But the full to return to full normalcy, there are people who have gone back to their home, they have to return back. And because of still some of the restrictions in terms of social distancing, etc., to some extent, it does affect the productivity, but I hope that the thing should be coming to normal. As far as demand is concerned, I already mentioned, it is quite a good recovery. We are happy with it. Our refineries are operating at 100% of the capacity now. As far as the liquidity part is concerned, I already mentioned, is it out substantially. And I got a reason to believe that unless there are any second way of things at a substantial level, the worst is passed through. So with this initial comments, I open myself to whichever the queries any of your guests may have, and me and my colleagues will try to answer it, and if we are not able to, we'll get you the answer. Thank you so much. Yeah, so if any questions are there, we can take the questions. Hello? Hello?
Hello. Yep. Yeah, sir, this is Nitin here. We shall wait for the question queue to assemble and then we'll start taking the questions, sir.
Okay. Thank you. In the meantime, probably I can mention something about the future. That during the past period, we saw quite low cracks in on MNs, HSD, etc. because of low demand and surplus inventories. But the way it is appearing, the demand is picking up in US, in European countries, in China, and even in India. And that is also reflecting in an improvement in cracks. So the diesel cracks have already come to around $6, $6 to $7. And that's a good sign. And therefore, we do hope that this should augur well for the refinery GRMs. Refinery GRMs in the last period had seen a negative trend. In fact, the Singapore cracks were running negative side. I think it did touch the lowest in last 10 years. But the projections are that they are also turning into the positive territory. And I think that the with the improvement in cracks, with the lower crude prices, I think it should augur better for the refinery setup. As far as the crude prices are concerned, crude prices had been running now at around $40. There was a steep fall to $13. There was a steep rise to $35 to $40. The reasons are the same. What brought it down, that there was a sudden collapse of demand and surplus inventories. That is picked up because there is a faster than expected recovery in the demand. And there are the additional restrictions on the supply which are imposed by OPEC Plus. This was also added by some of the shale producers going out of the system because of very low prices and they're becoming unviable. But if the crude prices goes higher, they return back and that much production comes back. But there are also concerns from some part of the country on some additional cases found in Beijing. Some of the high number of cases reported from some of the places in US and India also, the things have yet to return to normal. So as far as demand is concerned, world demand, while it picked up quite fast, it continued to pick up at the same place is maybe people have still to wait and see. And that is the reason that we believe that the crude prices may remain at this level right now. And if it goes higher than that, some of the shale producers will jump into the system. Also, the OPEC cuts are required to be reduced step-wise as was announced. In fact, in June, the 2 million barrels was supposed to come in the system, which they extended for June, and they are supposed to return back from July. And in January, again, some additional barrels have to come. So if the demand doesn't pick up to that extent, because there are already substantial surplus inventory which will get absorbed over a period of time, we do believe that the crude prices remain in this range for some time to come, and we expect the cracks to improve from the level where they are. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking your question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. We have a first question from the lineup, Rohit Ahuja from BOB Capital Markets. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity and thank you for giving such a detailed explanation of the fundamentals. Still have a little bit of questions. So on the normalcy of the business, both on the front of refinery margin and marketing margins, You believe you already touched that normalized in terms of fundamentals, and your GRMs, when we adjust for the inventory losses, look to be exceptionally higher in Q4. So, as you had mentioned that there were excess oil inventory built up globally, did you get an advantage of discounted Middle East crude, and does it still continue, do you still continue to have that advantage? Thanks.
As far as the marketing is concerned, I already mentioned that we are already seeing the demand almost touching 85 to 90% of the normal. When I say normal, means the same month of the last year, because that is the best way to compare, because there is a seasonality impact which comes. So as far as marketing demand is concerned on MS and HSD, it is already touched 85%, and I expect it to touch 90% soon, maybe this month end or early next month. In fact, to be very honest with you, today we do have the supplies of 90%, but I'm only seeing whether it is a sustained thing or not. But otherwise, if you see today's figure, we have the 90% offtake today. As far as ATF is concerned, it is yet to pick up fully. It is around 30% right now. As far as LPG is concerned, we already have more than 100% of the sale even during the complete lockdown situation, because most of the people were at home. Everybody had a desire to keep both the cylinders full. The consumption of LPG was higher because more people at home, more cooking. Then there was a PMU-based beneficiaries offtake. So the LPG consumption was almost 115% of normal. That is as far as marketing is concerned. Now, as far as refinery is concerned and the GRM, $10.6 inventory loss is an exceptional loss. 1.23 negative is also an exceptional. Core GRM of 9.37 is a result of these two factors. Now, just for the benefit of the understanding, because there is a time gap between the crude and the product, and because it was exceptionally different crude pricing regime, so there is an element of the timing factor of it. But even if we discount it and be fully on conservative basis also, it will be more than $6.5 to $7. So that's one part I'll tell. But this is the way normally the GRMs are calculated. Okay. So in a stable regime, that this type of differences will not come, but otherwise that's the case. That way, the whole year you see the evened out impact of $4.3 core GRM in spite of the lower cracks for most of the year.
Right.
So that shows the strength of the system as far as the refineries are concerned. Now, as far as the marketing margins are concerned, one of the questions which many people would have had in their mind, and they would have been raising, that it was static for the most of the lockdown period. Then there was some question that whether it is being aligned or not, and then there is subsequent part where the price are increasing. As you are aware, there was substantial volatility in the crude oil and the product prices. The domestic product prices are aligned to the international product prices. Now, international product prices do not move exactly in tandem on the same day as the crude prices movement.
Right.
In this particular situation, the crude prices were guided by the reason different than the product prices movement.
Mm-hmm.
So there was substantial volatility. At the same time, the demand has contracted substantially because of the lockdown. So it was thought is prudent to maintain the prices so that it doesn't lead to unnatural inventory gains, loss, holdings, etc. Now, after some sort of stability has reached, when the crude prices are reaching to stability, the product prices are coming guided by more demand supply pattern, the prices are being aligned to the international prices, and that is why, because the crude prices increased, the product prices are also increasing everyday basis, as you are seeing, and it will continue to be aligned up or down, whichever way it moves. The second element which comes is the cracks. And the third element is the exchange rate. So you also know that the exchange rate has moved to $76 a barrel. The product price also on gasoline and gas oil has moved a little bit up. So the domestic prices see a combined impact of all this and not only the crude prices. The last element is the product prices in India is based on a 15 days rolling basis. So both increase and decrease has got a certain amount of moderation. So in future also, we will continue to ensure that the domestic prices remain in general alignment with the international product prices. There may be a little bit of moderation to ensure that there are no unnecessary volatility in the market to that extent.
So the excise duty, all the duty hikes we've had over the last 1 month have been passed on now completely?
Yeah, rather the excise duty hike had been absorbed in the, not by the companies, in the product prices. I mentioned to you it was a lower crude prices, but the prices
were steady.
So it got absorbed in that. So to that extent, that impact has already been considered now. And so is the Euro 6 impact also.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. In the interest of time and fairness to all participants, participants are requested to restrict questions to 2 per participant. We have next question from the line of Avinash Vazirani from Jupiter Asset. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir, for that very extensive commentary. One question and a clarification. Historically, we've seen the inventory losses and gains kind of wipe each other out over a period of, you know, 12 to 18 months on a rolling basis. You had massive losses last year. Do you see them kind of being recovered, quote unquote, in the near future? I know you made a press comment about inventory gains in the current quarter, you know, some time ago. So that's question number one, and I'll come on to the other one, if I may.
Okay. So you want to put the second question also, and then I answer?
Yeah, sure. The second question was to do with GRMs after upgrades. Does it actually go up? And you mentioned something about Euro 6. Does that mean there's an extra margin being made to cover that cost?
Okay, so the first part, yes, I did made it, some comment on that, because when the crude prices came down drastically, we did suffer a substantial inventory loss in the last quarter, which you have seen and which I explained to you in the initial opening remarks of mine. Now, after that, there is a sharp pickup in the crude prices, and if nothing abnormal happens in the next 2 weeks, we should see some amount of inventory gains in this quarter. So to that extent, you are correct that in a long cycle, the inventory gains and loss balance each other. So it is more because quarter to quarter and year to year we do, and it depends on which time those type of spikes are there. In this case, it did happen very close to March end, and it was very sharp, unprecedented. So there was substantial inventory loss. And the pickup in April and May is substantial, reasonable. And therefore, we hope that we should be having the inventory gains in the quarter one. The second part is regarding the TRM. So as far as BS6 is concerned, there is an additional cost which the companies have incurred in terms of putting up those facilities, and there is an additional cost which you incur for operating those facilities, because more deeper sulfur when you remove, more amount of hydrogen you consume. So there is an element in the pricing now which accounts for that additional cost, and that is already built up in the prices. Because the prices were low, it got absorbed without actually the people feeling the pinch of it earlier. As far as the revamp part is concerned, we have got the benefit of additional capacity being available now in the secondary processing units in Vizag refinery, which will be good enough for the additional primary capacity for which the new units are coming and under construction advanced stages. So it gives me a benefit that we will not be required to take a second shutdown for the expansion unit hookup now. So when we did the upgrade for BS6, we parallelly also completed those units revamps where the job was required in existing units. Now, whether immediately you see the impact of that in GRM, I won't think so, because it has to get added with the capacity expansion. So as soon as the capacity expansion starts coming in, you will start seeing some of the advantage, because the newer units will be more efficient than what the earlier units are. Lower capacity, like in Vizag, you get a full one CD of 9 million ton. So you will, and that the hydrocracker and all those units, so you get the benefit of this. And then followed by slurry cracker or the receipt cracker, which gives substantial addition to GR. Does it answer your question?
Yeah, so just one question on your gas business. We're sort of struggling to get all the details of us and, in fact, external ESG analysts trying to figure out all your gas businesses. So you mentioned you have 476 outlets of CNG. I mean, that's overall in the country, only like 2,300. Are you kind of saying that you have nearly 25% of the country's CNG retail capacity?
Okay, so let me tell you one thing. Even the CGD entities who claim that they've got so many outlets, actually the outlets are ours. Most of the outlets where the CNG is being sold belong to oil marketing companies, except if they are out and out pure CNG stations, which are few. Now, when you do the selling of the CNG at our outlets, we also get a part of the profit of that. So does the dealer also get. And a part goes to the CGD entity, which has got a gas authorization in that area. So we have got, as of today, 476 outlets on which we are selling CNG. And we have got a very focused program to increase it substantially. And we have got one inherent advantage that we already have the stations, we already have got the area, we have already got the place, we already got the running outlets. We only need to put the gas compressor and the dispensing units on those stations, so we can scale it up very quickly. So this is not only about selling. So we are present now almost in the whole of the value chain of gas. Right, starting from the gasification terminal, which is coming up in Chaha, along in partnership with Tata Sons, Shapoorji Palanji company. So we have got a 5 million metric ton LNG gasification terminal coming, that's one. Then there are two cross-country pipelines where we are, this in JV with various companies, so we are a part of that. We have got 11% stake in that. Then we have got the CGD authorization for 20 geographical areas spread over 9 states in the country. And then we have got the 476 outlets from which we are already selling, but we can sell from full 16,000 outlet CNG going forward. So that is the complete business of CNG if it comes to the question.
Is it available on your website? Because we're having a bit of, as I said, us and others. You know, it'd be great if you could
might
put
not
it
be so, but if you wish, we can put it. It's not a secret information. We can definitely put it.
Sure.
But not the way I explained to you. It is there in various places, but maybe not in a consolidated fashion. We will try to control. But what I told you, it gives you a view of our guest business.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Aishwarya Agarwal from Nippon India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Sir, thank you very much for the conference call in this turbulent time. I really appreciate the pressure, sir. How we should look at the CapEx in FY21-22 in terms of quantum and the details in terms of project-wise on a very broader level?
So we had planned for a capex of around 12,000 crore in this year, and broadly it will be 5,000 crore on the marketing side and 7,000 crore on the refinery side.
And
it includes the existing projects which are going on, like expansion projects, the equity contribution for Barmer refinery, everything it includes.
That's a, if you look at this number, and historically if you see, we are making some 10 to 11,000 crores of EBITDA, and we have 1,000 crores of interest, 2,000 crores of taxes, 1,500 dividends, so 4,500 crores is straight away gone. And then remaining part, say 5,000 crores, 6,000 crores is left out, and 10,000 crores is the capex. So effectively our leverage will increase by 6,000 crores in this year, even if we do very good numbers.
This question every year is asked to me, and I always answer this question. And at the end of the year, somebody asked me that if your projects are going, where from you are getting the money, because your debt to equity ratio is not going up substantially. Mm-hmm. So we do generate around 8,000 to 9,000 crore as internal resources. Okay. And our gearing ratio right now on long-term debt is less than one as of today. Our projects which we do the projects in two ways. One thing is either through joint ventures or on our own balance sheet. So, for example, our Chhara Terminal or Barmer Refinery are on a joint venture. So, their debt is on that balance sheet, not on our balance sheet. Because we are partner in this business itself, It makes those projects itself self-sufficient to have their own borrowing. For example, the Barmer refinery had, this was, I think, very few projects which had the AA rating for a greenfield project. And that that had a funding on its own without actually having any direct recourse to us. Similarly, even Chhara projects also. So our joint venture projects or the subsidiary projects are their debt does not actually reflect to us. So basically we need debt only for the purpose of doing the projects which are on our own balance sheet, or to the extent we are required to make the contributions of equity, etc., to those. And to that extent our credibility has been quite good. In fact, to just quote you an example, recently you might be knowing that Bharat Bond came for the new instrument for various AAA rated companies or something, PSUs or Maharatnas, ETF. Now, in that, the scheme was that first you have to float your NCD, and then whatever the rate you get based on that, in the Bharat Bond instrument will take the ETF at the same rate. And I think it is a published information. If you see, HTCL rate of interest is not one of the lowest. I think it is the lowest in all those, even better than some of the companies in my own sector. So that shows the strength of the company as far as borrowing is concerned. I may also said that in the past also, we got one of the best rates, even when earlier we floated a foreign currency bond. That was the best squeeze on the spread which any Indian corporate had got in oil sector in last 10 years. Even when recently we had borrowed the money on the CP also, that was one of the best rates. So the company doesn't enjoy a market credibility which helps us to borrow the money at a very, very efficient rate. And to that extent, when we approve any project, we do quite a diligence to ensure that how the serviceability is there. And normally, we do not plan any project, or we don't take a capex which doesn't have an IRR, number one. And the second thing is, which crosses our threshold limit of debt to equity ratio or debt servicing ratio. And those are slightly more stringent than what the banks permit.
Sure. And sir, one last one. We generally say that we should look at the refining marketing business as a portfolio, and when one business is not doing good, the other will take care of. So we apply that. Should we assume this year in terms of financial number comes out to be a normal year for us going forward, despite whatever has happened in the last 2.5 months?
I do not want to do any crystal gazing, but I don't have a reason to believe that there is any reason for you not to believe that.
Sure.
We do hope that the that, as I mentioned to you, that had one quarter does not decide the fate of the company, nor the strength of the company. Otherwise, we would not have been in this business for 100 years. I don't know how many of you know that HPCL is in the business since 1910. In the avatar of earlier Standard Oil Company, from there we started. So it is almost 110 years we are in this business. And the company survives 110 years, it has to have something in it. So we would have seen many of these ups and down cycles. And as of today, the way it is appearing, I got reason to believe that unless something, we have got a serious spread, second wave, something drastically wrong going, which completely destroys the demand. I do believe that a part of the loss of the last quarter should be again in this year.
Sure. Sure, sir. Best of luck. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Amy Chustel from Jupiter Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Hi there. Thanks very much for taking my question. Sort of a follow-up to Avanash's question on the gas, sort of ESG-related business. What is the kind of rough IRR for that business, if you're able to split it out? And, you know, just wondering whether you're able to report EBITDA and assets by activity so we can kind of better figure out sort of what the rate of return is in these types of businesses.
Can you repeat the question? I'm sorry, I didn't get. I got the last part, that whether it can be given sector-wise. What was the first part of it regarding gas business?
What the sort of rough IRR on that old return on investment?
What is the sort of IRR you ask? Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So, as I mentioned to you, the total business is consisting of various elements. So as far as gasification terminal and the pipeline project, they have got an independent IRR. As far as the CGD business, what you call city gas distribution, it has got a different sort of IRR. But I can tell you that the overall this business meets the IRR norms which the company has. Because we don't take up a project if it is not meeting the IRR now.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, yeah, I think we're just sort of struggling to sort of figure out how to look at that business because, you know, we see other businesses like IDL where the market cap of that company is larger than HPCL with a much smaller gas business. So, is there another way that we can look at that information?
So, I can just for the sake of benefit, if it gives an indication, we had not been reporting the sector-wise profitability because there are reasons for doing or not doing it both ways. But I can tell you that our CGD business, we also have got some of the JV companies, where at least three of them for city gas distribution. So just to get an example on two, each of them has got three geographical areas, and both of them have made profits. So, if that gives an answer, that the CGD companies have made profits. Our own joint ventures, where we own 50%. 50% is owned by GAIL India Limited. So, both of these entities have made profit, which has been in operation for some time now. Of course, these are unlisted companies, so you will not see those figures in the outside world. In fact, it will be good for me to give some view of the probably the joint ventures which we have, because those are not known to many people. So we have got a joint venture with Kolas for making bitumen emulsions. So there we had started with an equity of 5 crores, and that company makes a profit of 100 crores per year now. And initially we had started one plant, and that company has got 11 plants. So they make a specialized bitumen emulsion, and most of the airport carpeting which you see, that product is supplied by them. That is a joint venture between us and Kolas of France. Then we have got a SALPG, which is a joint venture between HPCL and Total. And that has got the first cavern, LPG cavern in Asia, and one of the deepest caverns in India. And that has the storage capacity of 60,000 tons per annum. Then we have got a joint venture refinery in Bathinda, which is with ArcelorMittal, which is an 11.3 million metric ton capacity, and that is also setting up an additional petrochemical complex. Additionally, we have got the joint venture companies with Gail India for city gas business called Avantika Gas and Bhagyanagar Gas. Bhagyanagar Gas has got the authorization for Hyderabad, Vijayawada, Kakinada, while the Avantika Gas has got the authorization for Indore, Ujjain, Gwalior. And we have got a number of other companies. So total 19 companies are there. And most of these companies are in profit. So I thought that it will give some indication of that. There are reasons why we have not been reporting the sector-wise business, but that request has come a number of times. But in a broad basis, I can say that we have got the refining business, marketing business. We have got a quite strong pipeline network and lube business, and now the gas business which is adding, and in future the petrochemical business which will get added.
Thank you. That's really helpful, and you know we appreciate any data that you are able to give us to sort of better understand these businesses. Thanks.
Thank you. In the interest of time and fairness to all participants, ladies and gentlemen, please restrict questions to one per participant. We have next question from the line of Probal Sen from Centrum Broking. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much for the opportunity, sir. So with respect to the CAPEX plans, and you have mentioned this before, that there has been no change in the CAPEX guidance for FY21. But based on, you know, what you said in terms of the project sites and the fact that, you know, they are still maybe about a month away from actually getting back to full capacity, if not more. Is it unrealistic to assume that there could be some slippages, you know, maybe by about 10-20% in terms of achieving the CAPEX for this year? And 10,000 crore could be a more realistic number in case, you know, the ramp up takes a bit more time. That was my first question.
I won't rule out the possibility completely, because to be very honest with you, nobody has got absolute clarity on how the full normalcy will return, and how fast and how quickly it will return, and whether there are possibility of a recurrences of the cases. So if I say that no, that is where it will be wrong on my part. This is what our estimation is there. If the recovery takes time, definitely the capex expenditure will be lesser than that. That I agree. Because I mentioned that our projects are at advanced stage, we have got a desire to complete it as early as possible so that we start getting benefit of it. Mm-hmm. The second part is we have already started on it. And one good point is most of the material and the equipment we already have our own site. So that is one advantage. To that extent, we are not actually dependent on outside world supplies now. Okay, it's because almost all the material and the equipment are not only at site, they are on their foundation, they are already in the system now. So it is basically the activities which goes on is piping, welding, instrumentation, electrical, insulation, those type of activities which are going on. And where, because that could have been another worry if the substantial material is to come from outside.
Sure.
For commissioning of some critical equipment, we may need the foreign experts to come. So if there are restrictions, that can be one thing.
Right.
The migrant workers do not return fully. then that can be one of the issues. One thing is because of the monsoon, the pre-monsoon period we have lost. So that is one thing which can have some impact, because during monsoon, the productivity becomes lesser.
So if I understand you correctly, so what you're saying is that
Sir, I'm sorry to interrupt. Would you like to come back in the question queue?
Thank you. Question of the question I asked. Can I complete my question?
Yeah, please do, sir.
Thank you, sir. I was saying that if I understand you correctly, sir, if the logistics part is well taken care of, because you have proactively got all the equipment, the only thing I'm not sure of whether all the labor, as and when, the manpower or the foreign experts, those could be the only constraints, possibly.
That's what I think. And the second part I mentioned to you, that the pre-monsoon period, which
right, the seasonality factor. Right, right.
Yes, that's correct.
Thank you, sir. I have more questions. I'll come back if I get the opportunity. Thank you so much for sparing the time.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Pinakin Parekh from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. So my question is just on a broader marketing business. If you look at it, every year the marketing business has a capex ranging between 4,000 to 5,000 to 6,000 crores a year. And we add more retail outlets, we add more pipelines, and a lot more infrastructure. How do we understand the returns on this business? I mean, what kind of marketing margins do we need to see to justify an IRR? Are those margins there over the last 18 to 24 months? Have margins averaged to justify those investments, or do we need to see margin expansion to cover up the cost of capital or an adequate return on that expense capex? And is this a capex number which we should assume that on the marketing business every year for the next few years would be required, running into 4,000 to 5,000 crores?
Let me answer this question in slightly different way than the way you asked, because you are assuming that the marketing capex includes only retail outlets. So the marketing capex includes the cross-country pipeline, it includes the LPG plants, it includes the terminals and depots, and some portion for retail outlets. Now, as far as cross-country pipelines, retail terminals, LPG plants, more of the volume comes, the better it is, because that gives on the same facility higher returns. As far as the petrol pumps, etc. are concerned, there the full investment is not ours. A part of the investment is of dealers, part of the investment is ours. And again, the retail outlet is installed only if we have a reasonable assessment of the throughput which it will do, and there is a break-even threshold, then only we issue the dealership, otherwise we do not. Now, every year going forward, whether we'll have 4,000, 5,000 crore or so, we always have got a list of the projects, and we, depending on what is the funding pattern, the external generation, and the prioritization. So we have got a certain projects which are like replacement, safety, operational requirement projects, and certain projects which are IRR projects. So safety or etc. projects or replacement projects we do, and the IRR project, we take the highest IRR projects at top, and we allocate. So we always have inventory of projects, and we always take a call that which projects we will take, which will not, and overall synergy of the thing. So sometime, now as far as the refinery side is concerned, you don't have the refinery like expansion type of project every time. So this project once get over, those type of projects won't come. Like you are not going to have another expansion of IG refinery immediately, or another expansion of Mumbai refinery immediately, or a new LNG terminal, or that won't happen. But let's say pipeline. Okay, we have completed, let's say, Palantir-Odabra pipeline, but we have got the Vijayawada-Dharmapuri pipeline going on. So you will have, and because the pipeline always gives a logistic benefit in terms of transportation costs, etc. And in fact, there is a reasonable part of our profitability which gets which comes from this type of logistics management, and we have done quite some job in last 3 or 4 years to improve our logistic realignment of secondary transportation, etc., and we have got a benefit of it.
Understood. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have next question from the line of Ashwani Kumar from Nippon India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, Mr. Surana. My question was that how are you using IIoT or the digitization processes to improve the various aspects in refining and marketing?
I'm glad that you asked this question, because this thing, I think I should have put it in the initial my comment, and I forgot, not only today, even yesterday, even in the morning. So HPCL has taken is working very aggressively on the digital part. In fact, we got two major part of things which are happening. One thing is we have taken up an ERP upgrade program. That is one. And second thing, we had recently carved out a digital strategy thing with some of the consultants. And as such, HPCL had been quite a forefront in using the digital technologies. Right from the way back when the first computer in India came to HPCL, I don't know how many of you know that in 1962, the first commercial computer of IBM was brought by our predecessor, ASO, and it was installed in the place where I'm sitting right now.
Yeah.
And we are very aggressively looking at IoT, analytics. In fact, some of the analytics projects which we already implemented, and we are using that, especially in the marketing side of it. And in the refinery side, on the asset management part of it, and in the pipelines, especially for the scheduling and intrusion detection, intrusion and leak detection. So we have already implemented some of the projects, and we have got certain projects which are already lined up, and we are working something directly by us, something by along with some of the startups which we are supporting. And in terms of on the customer facing points, there are a number of initiatives which some of you would have seen and some of you may be seeing. For example, there is a app called HP Pay, and that is a unified solution for all payments in the field. There is a new device which can pick up the retail automation system integrated to the payment system. So you pay only what is filled. So it is not that the forecourt buys punches is the quantity for calculating a number. There is always a possibility of error, or somebody may not be sure whether that is happening. So the system picks up the thing directly from the dispensing pump and bill you only that. In fact, it is even further advanced. It can recognize your car. It can directly charge from the distance. You can say that I want to fill up this, and that the system will know that, okay, this is what is supposed to fill. So there are a number of things which are being doing. So basically on the refinery side, on asset management, on the logistic part, on the customer facing part, and on the internal processes, something which we have learned during this pandemic time to work from home. So these are all being leveraged. We have not gone into blockchain as of today, let me be honest with you, but the other things we are doing, IoT, artificial intelligence, in fact, even virtual reality projects which we have got on training and independent
asset management.
So, will
it help cost or market share?
Beg your pardon?
Will it help you reduce cost or increase market share, or both?
Both. Why only market, even refining also?
Thank you.
Even operations also.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Amit Rustagi from UBS. Please go ahead.
Sir, good evening, and thanks for a very informative call. Sir, could you share the performance of HMEL refinery for the last financial year, the operating performance as well as the financial performance, if possible?
Yeah, so as far as HMEL's refinery is concerned, it made a loss of 66 crores. So compared to MRPL standalone refinery, it did well. But yes, it also posted a loss of 66 crores. As far as operationally, they did well. They had been able to utilize the full capacity, the expanded capacity of 11.3 million metric tons. Their GRMs are normally better than the other refineries, but it was lesser compared to earlier. They used to post double-digit figure of GRMs. It was not double-digit this time, but it was still quite good compared to many of the other refineries. As far as their expansion project is concerned, it is progressing well, and they are hoping to complete by 2021 sometime. Yeah, during in fact, initially they had a plan somewhere in April 21, but now some part of this impact will have there. So we are expecting some 3 to 4 months delay there. So somewhere by mid of 21, that project will get completed, the petrochemical. One good part was that they had the least number of days of project work shut down even during lockdown. So they had a workers' colony and they could retain almost most of their workers during that period. So the 14,000 workers they retained during the lockdown period also.
Sure, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Amit Shah from BNP Paribas. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Just one question. How do you see the marketing margins panning out from here on? Is it fair to say that there can be a time where annually there are basically the instances where you can actually charge a higher marketing margin, and there are times where you actually are lower than your threshold, and then on an annualized basis you average out? And what is that average number, especially on gasoline and diesel, if you can share? Thank you.
I think your question is has many questions in it. There may be days where you may feel that why it is static and why it is not moving, and some days you may feel that exactly the reverse way also. But on a long-term basis, the marketing margins are to ensure that we have got a healthy financial statement. At the same time, there is no unnecessary burden to the consumers because of the additional profits to us. Now, that remains the case that as a PSU organization, we cannot and we do not want to also charge the windfall gains just because an opportunity arises. At the same time, being a commercial enterprise, we also need to ensure that our financial statements are healthy. Now, within these broad parameters, we follow certain processes and principles, and it is not ad hocism the way any of you might think that why the sizes are so or not so. So there are certain principles which we follow, and you may appreciate that being a government companies, we can't do any way other than that. So to that extent, I can only say that we have the reasonable marketing margins as of today, while aligning the prices to international system, which is good enough to cover our costs and which is reasonable to make reasonable profit. Now, how much profit is good enough, that is that the different people may have different opinions about it. But whatever the margins you people are normally used to see, that we have. But definitely some point you might be thinking there were very, very abnormal margins, and sometime you would have thought there under recoveries. There may be times like that, but on the long run basis it is a reasonable range.
Would it be fair to say it's around 2 rupees?
I will right now resist from, not that I don't know, but I don't want to make an statement on the margins, because that remains a sensitive subject in more than one ways. So what is good for you to know may not be good for you in real terms.
Okay, no problem. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Vidyadhar Ginde from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. So my question was mainly on the crude which HPCL uses. So if you could just give us some color on by source which is Saudi Arabia, Iraq, so that we could get some idea on the kind of discounts you enjoyed in the current quarter.
So we predominantly source our Middle East, the high sulfur crude from Middle East, and the low sulfur crude, low and medium sulfur crude, we have used both Africa as well as US.
Could you give us some numbers, say what proportion comes from Saudi Arabia, Iraq, UAE,
so
that kind of thing?
No, the I'm not sure whether you know how the crude sourcing is done. See, we have got the optimization models. There is a yearly plan which we draw.
Mm-hmm.
And there are term contracts, there are option, there are firm term contracts and optional term contracts, as well as there are spot contracts.
Mm-hmm.
So while on a broad basis and yearly, we will have certain economics which we work out based on that we decide. So it is not always that the same crude is the topmost choice for us. Generally, it may happen depending on the configuration of the refineries, but depending on the relative advantages and disadvantages, it may change also. But predominant source of crude are Saudi Arabia, then UAE, Iraq. In recent time, we did buy from US, then in the West African countries. Actually, we have got around 100 types of crude in our basket, but normally around 10 to 12 type of crude, which normally we get. Additionally, we also get Mumbai High crude.
Agreed, but so if you could give me what proportion was last year domestic and then the rough proportions at 20.
So around, if we are processing 18.5 million ton, around 4 to 4.5 million ton we get domestically and rest is imported.
So imported, could you give some color in terms of Saudi Arabia, Iraq, proportion 20%, 10%, whatever?
That is a contractual part of it, so I do not want to tell it in so many straight manner. But we can say that around total crude basket, around 65% comes from the Middle East.
Mm.
And the remaining 35% comes from domestic and the West African market.
And 65 would be basically UAE, Saudi Arabia, and Iraq.
Saudi Arabia, Iraq, and UAE. Some quantity from Kuwait, and this also can come. But predominantly from these three countries.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Bhavin Gandhi from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question, sir. If you could just help us with the timelines of the commissioning of all three projects, Barmer, Vizag and the Mumbai refinery.
So as far as Vishak is concerned, we are because I already mentioned that we have lost some 2-3 months in between, and so I am expecting next calendar year we should definitely be commissioning the Vizag refinery expansion. That's Mumbai and Vizag both. Because Mumbai we could have done in this calendar year also, but now the monsoon is setting in, so because that is a revamp type of project in Mumbai, so we won't be taking in doing that part in monsoon season. So as far as somewhere in the middle of the next calendar year, Mumbai should be there, and Vizag also before the end of the next calendar year. As far as Barmer is concerned, it is slated only for 23.
Got it. Thank you.
And in Vizag, the bottom upgradation facility is 22.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Nitin Tiwari from Antique Stock Broking. Please go ahead, sir.
Sir, if I may put one question to you. So I was listening to the explanation that you gave around the CGD business, that where you said that the business can be expanded to all the 16,000 outlets that you have for petroleum retailing as well. So is there any thought towards moving away from a commission based business model in CGD to a complete operatorship, given that PNGRB is also?
Yes. Okay. So you may see in tomorrow a dealer-owned, dealer-operated, complete CNG station.
Right. Thank you, sir.
So you may see that, definitely. That is definitely it.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much.
Just like a normal retail outlet for petrol, diesel, you may have the dealers for CNG.
So my question was more from the perspective that today we have shared outlets with CGD companies. So is there a possibility that we get out of that sharing and commission based mechanism to a complete owned outlet that we operate and
No, I think you misunderstood that.
Right.
There's no outlet which is shared with the CGD companies. Outlets always belongs to us.
Okay.
The CGD companies, see, the model is like this, that when the PNGRB bid out the geographical areas, the CGD company gets the right for supplying gas in that geographical area.
Right, sir.
Now, that is, so he lays down the pipelines, etc., to bring the gas to that geographical area.
Right.
Now, as far as PNG is concerned, piped natural gas, that right those people get. As far as PNG, the compressed natural gas on the petrol pumps, etc., what you get is either he can set up his own station.
Or he'll share with you.
Or he can, or I can allow him to stay on my station. So he gets certain commission for supplying gas to me up to the gas station. And for selling the gas, I get a commission which I share between me and my dealer.
Correct, sir. So given
But if it is my own CGD area, just like I mentioned, we got 20 geographical areas.
Right, sir.
That all the three are mine. That's
right, sir. So my question was more from the perspective of the geographical area of the CGD company, because the NGRB is working on a notification where competition could be introduced to third party access in existing geographical areas of a CGD company. So there, would
we can set up. Then, there is a time limit, like in Mumbai and Delhi and all. Now, those time limits are now approaching to an end where the original IGL and NGL had the authorization.
Right.
And there, the other people may also be allowed that notification, I think, yet to come on that.
Yeah. So, in that situation, you will consider setting up your own completely owned and operated stations.
Yes. In the geographical areas which are ours, we can anyway set it up.
Yes, that's yes.
But in other areas also, we can, if suppose the CGD company comes out with a model, that is one part of it, but where the time limit of exclusivity is gone, yes, the people can set it up.
Sure.
But the first part which I mentioned about the RODO model, I was talking about the areas where we have got our own geographical areas. That's what I mentioned to you before.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Mayank Maheshwari from Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
So thank you for this call and really informative. My first question was more related to, sir, Vizag expansion itself. So how much do you think will it contribute to your GRM, and when do you think it can fully ramp up to?
I think I earlier also mentioned this, that when the project is fully completed, see, the project had three parts, rather four parts. One was BS6, one was the revamp of the existing units, one are the new capacity addition units, and one is bottom upgradation units. So there are four elements to that. The first two parts I mentioned we have completed, that is BS6 and the revamp of the existing facility to increase their capacity to cater to the new primary unit. The new primary units and the bottom upgradation units are in progress. Now, certain addition in GRM will come because of the capacity increase itself and because of the more efficient units, more energy efficiency, etc. And then another jump in the GRM comes because of the whole of the bottom get upgraded to a distillate. So these are the two elements. After the full capacity and the full thing is, so even without the bottom upgradation, because I said that one unit is coming slightly later, later means that will have a gap of a year, because we can't be commissioning all the units together and they work, the output of one goes into another. And also the construction wise also, that is way it is. The 14.5 million ton capacity will reach without the bottom upgradation unit commission, means just after the new units are commissioned. That is what I'm saying, that next calendar year, middle of next calendar year, that should be possible. And this, because there's a 9 million unit, single unit, modern, efficient, so it will bring certain GRM. And then the bottom duration comes, sir. But after that comes, it will be more than double digit. So we are expecting.
Got it. Thank you, sir.
Double digit. It should add total $6 plus $6 to $8 GRM addition to what we get today on the total capacity.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Saurabh Handa from Citigroup. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. One quick question on the financials. Could you provide the EBITDA split between refining and marketing, either for the quarter or the year, as you've been doing for the last few quarters?
EBITDA?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the full year, refining had a loss and marketing had a profit. Marketing had contributed to around 7,300 crore of EBITDA, and refinery had a loss of 1,815 crore. This is including gain, inventory gains, loss, everything. The refinery had 2,960 crore inventory losses. Marketing had 1,293 crore inventory losses. So basically, refinery had higher inventory losses because of crude, intermediates, and the finished good, all the three, while marketing has got only the finished good part of it. And the cycle of time in the marketing is much shorter compared to refineries. And in the refineries, even the crude which is on the ship is also counted as an inventory of ours as soon as it left the port. So there was a higher refinery inventory losses, which that is why the reported GRMs were lesser.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Abhishek Datta from Prabhudas Lilladher. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Just wanted to check, like, I didn't get the HMEL GRM for the full year you mentioned, sir.
Yeah, I did not mention it also. I just said that normally they make double digit GRM. This year also they did quite good compared to other refineries, but it is not double digit. That's what I said. Only said that total overall they had a loss of 66 crore in the year.
Okay. And sir, can you just repeat the EBITDA of refining and marketing which you just mentioned, sir? I just missed that.
I mentioned that in marketing we had a positive EBITDA of 7,335 crore, and in the refinery we had a negative EBITDA of 1,815 crore. Another 1,442 was all other things.
Okay, so thank you so much.
Thank you. We have next question from the line of Vinod Bansal from Franklin Templeton. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. I have just a couple of basic questions. One, I'm sorry if I'm missing this, but in your debt number that you've given, 43,000 crores, is there an element of the lease liability in the S116 also in that?
What liability?
The lease liability in the S116 number, the lease capitalization.
Yes, it is there. It is there.
Could you explain what number that is?
What is that number? Lease liability. 2,900 crores.
2,912. All right. And if I may, in the asset side also, that number would be there, corresponding number?
Yes. So that is the accounting change which has come this year, and we have to that extent, debt includes that year.
Would you have the number?
2,900 crore, I mentioned.
On the liability side, on the asset side, I think.
I can get you. I'll ask somebody to get it. Right now, I don't have, but I'll get you that number.
Okay, and we discussed about the debt part, and I had this question as well, that your cost of debt seems to be lower than your two larger peers. And from whatever information one gets from the balance sheet and annual reports, instrument-wise, they're not too different in cost of each instrument. Where do you get the better cost of debt by almost 2 percentage points lower than your peers? Can you just detail more on that? How do you get a lower debt cost?
So it may be, I think, the mix of the instrument and the timing of it.
Doesn't look like, as I said, from whatever information you provide in annual reports, all three of you seem to have a similar mix. In fact, your forex debt is lower than the other two, which is generally cheaper than rupee debt. And again, instrument-wise, whether it's foreign currency bonds or the ECBs, which are linked to LIBOR.
What I'm trying to say is the timing when you get it in the market.
I didn't get the timing. Sorry, explain that. How do you mean it?
For example, just to give an example, in March month itself, somebody who did as a time T and somebody who did time T plus 15, there was a difference.
a difference of 2% consistently over here?
No. I am not saying it will make consistent difference. I am only trying to say that it does make a difference when you enter the market. That's one part. Second part is, how do you rotate your portfolio also? That's another part of it. Third is, how is the mix of your foreign versus local portfolio? So, foreign currency loan along with the hedging, that will be certain cost. But if you are, so sometimes that is advantageous, sometimes the local is advantageous. So, of course, it is a bit of a strategy part, but if you would have been studying our balance sheet over a period of time and our financial statement, we have consistently brought down our financing cost substantially. And it also has got a little bit of risk management part as far as the foreign currency is concerned. So it is a sum total of all these impacts, and we are very happy with it, to be very honest with you.
No, that's obvious. What I meant is,
so I'm sorry to interrupt. Would I like to come back in the question queue?
Let me just slip in one for the clarification.
I'm so sorry. Yeah. Please come back in the queue. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. We have next question from the line of Harsh Dole from IIFL. Please go ahead.
Well, thank you very much for taking my question. I have actually two questions. One, if you can just share the timelines for the integration of MRPL, and how soon and will this happen, and what milestone should we look out for? That's number one. And secondly, if I may, since HMEL is a significant portion of our equity invested in JVs, and we purchase significant amount of products from HMEL, it'd be nice if you can share at least the EBITDA number for HMEL, and if at all there is any significant inventory gain loss, I think that will be very helpful. Thank you.
The first part is that the timelines for MRPL right now we haven't formed up, so once we firm it up, then we will let you know. As far as HMEL is concerned, do we put the balance sheet? HMEL, we have got another partner, and they are the foreign listed companies. Mm-hmm. So to share those details, I need to slightly check it up, because if they're not put in the public domain, then whether we'll be able to put in public domain. To the extent the profits are accrued to us, that gets reflected in our balance sheet also. But to the extent of detail which you are mentioning, being an unlisted company, and because we have got a 50% partner who is listed abroad,
mm-hmm.
So we need to slightly check on that to share those details. Not that we have got any problem in sharing, but I was only thinking from the corporate governance point of view, we will check it up, and if it is possible, then we'll try to provide.
Sure, sir. Understood. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Manikanth Agare from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
Yes. But on that question, I can say that yes, they also had the inventory losses. That is true for all the companies, except that they did better than other standalone refineries. Like if you compare with MRPL or so, they had a loss of only -6 crores. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. I just want to check on the FO yield that was there for you in the Q4, and if I can add another question there. If there are any agreements signed for the Chara Aliquot Annual?
What is the last point? Chara?
If there are any agreements signed with customers for the Chara Aliquot Annual?
Agreement signed with the customers?
Yeah.
Customers means for sale of LNG, you are saying?
Yes, sir, for the sale of LNG and...
Not right now, because... that is a JV between us and Shapur Jipalanji, and we got a right for substantial portion of the capacity there. So subsequent part, how do we market? That is our part of the thing. So it is unlike the other terminals where the terminal is owned by somebody else, and they have to back-to-back tie up type thing.
Sure, Karan. What was the FO yield in Q4 for us?
I'll just let you know that FO yield. Yeah. You are from where, you said?
From Massachusetts.
Just get the FO. Yeah, I'll get you the FO capital. Yes. Yeah. FO yield, sorry. Yeah. Can we take the next question in the meantime once we get the FO?
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Varatharajan Shivashankar from Systematic Shares. Please go ahead.
Sir, thank you. So from the Rajasthan project, I would like to understand what is the downstream petrochemical capacities which are coming up, if you can give some details on that.
Yeah, so in Rajasthan, we are going to have 2 million ton of petrochemicals out of 9. And it will have PP, HGLP, HGP, LLDP, butadiene, these products will be there.
Any breakers, sir, in terms of capacities of those products?
I can get you right now. I'll get and give to you that also. Right now, I'm not having offhand with me, but I can give you.
Sure, thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of S. Ramesh from Nirmal Bang. Please go ahead.
Good evening, gentlemen. Thank you very much. Just like you shared the segment EBITDA between refining and marketing, and you also mentioned you make profits in pipelines and loops. So can you share the profits you got from pipelines and loops for FY20?
So pipelines and loops are a part of the marketing. But on the broader basis, make around 10 to 15% of profit on loops. Another 10 to 15% from pipeline.
And these are EBITDA margins.
Yes, I'm thinking of the marketing part of it.
Okay. Yeah.
And around 40% from the retail, then the broad basis. And another 30% from all our other businesses. Includes our direct sales, B2B, around. That will be the broader classification of the thing.
Okay, this is a split in the marketing EBITDA across the segments. Understood. Yeah, the second thought I have is, what are the initiatives you are taking on the electric vehicle charging? Because I believe you have a contract for 3,000 stations. And if you can also share your thoughts on whether you'll get into LNG retailing now that the regulator has allowed LNG retail without any authorization.
Yeah, there's a new announcement by PNGRB on the LNG retailing. Once we have the LNG gasification terminal, then we have got that also another possibility, because we will anyway be sourcing LNG. Now, it is the recent announcement where it has been said that LNG retailing does not need any authorization. Otherwise, earlier the gas, natural gas marketing was needing an authorization from PNGRB. So we will review that possibility of leveraging that. As I mentioned to you, if you are there in the whole segment, we can look at all the possibilities which are available. As far as EV charging is concerned, as of today, we have got EV charging facilities at 34 stations. And we have got certain agreements with some of the people who are in this business, MOUs, etc., the one who makes the batteries, the one who got certain models out there. And we are looking in this opportunity. Of course, in India, the EV, full-fledged EV charging is still a little bit far off. But we are definitely looking into the possibilities of doing that.
Thank you very much. All the best.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. We have next question from the line of Divya Pujari from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Sir, I have one question on funding side. So can you share your utilized and unutilized funding-based limits as of March 2020?
Sorry, I didn't get this. Can you just repeat the question, ma'am?
Yeah, I had a question on funding-based limits for your company. So what are the utilized, what is the limit that you've utilized already, and what are your unutilized limits as of March 2020?
So approved means from our own board or AGM, or which one you are talking about?
Sanctioned funding based limits.
No, sanctioned from whom?
Yeah, sanctioned, you know, from banks and, you know, other sources of financing.
No, we have got quite a substantial sanction, so we don't hit that limit at all. And in fact, because our substantial business goes on cash and carry, in fact, the whole of the retail business falls on cash and carry business. So we borrow only for the purpose of either the short-term borrowings for meeting the mismatches between receipts and payments or our projects. So with we got a consortium of banks which we deal with it, and we got limits with many banks, and because we are dealing with only limited number of banks, if you want, we can always get more also. So I don't think that is a concern. As far as sanctions from the banks are concerned, that is not a concern. Second thing is that even as far as our own AGM and shareholders concerned, those limits also we have never hit. So that's not an issue.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have the last question from the line of Vidyadhar Ginde from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Just wanted your thoughts on if you could share what kind of sales volume decline do you expect in the current quarter?
What type of?
You are going to be roughly flat or?
No, I didn't get. What type of? Can you repeat the question, please? Hello?
Fall should be mainly in retail.
No, in between I missed you. Can you repeat the question? Hello?
Mr. Ginde, we are not able to hear you. Please use the hand.
The question was that if you could share with us what could be the likely falling sales volumes in the current quarter, because the throughput is likely to be flat or maybe even some growth, but on the sales volume side, you should have some fall in auto fuels. So some indications if you could give it, would it be around
30%? I did mention in the beginning of my narration itself that in April month, we were having the total volume is 40%, which increased to 60%, which has reached now to 85 to 90%.
So you will be in line with the industry?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Somewhere we are better, somewhere somebody else may be better, depending on which area has got opened up to what extent. All the companies have got their own strong areas where they are the market leaders. So depending on the impact of the pandemic, but overall, it will be in the range of 1% here or there. That's all.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments. So over to you.
Yeah, there were just two questions. I will get the detail. And before I close, I get the detail, I will tell that was one of the FO yield and another was on the HMEL product slate bifurcation. But otherwise, I hope that we had been able to answer most of the questions which are there. And I hope that would have clarified some of the lingering doubts which the people may have in their mind regarding the general situation, the sector situation, and the company's result. And I thank you all the analysts and the investors for being continuously with us, having faith and trust.